Well, hi everybody. I'm Bill Whittle, back with our friend Alfonso Rachel, and this is the Virtue Signal, where we try to talk about some of the morality and the philosophy behind the actual politics of the day. Zoe, good to see you again. How you been?
I am doing well, sir. How you doing?
I'm doing beautifully.
Right on.
Absolutely spectacular. Busy as a bee. So in our very first episode, when we talked about the entire idea of virtue, you mentioned that one of the problems with the whole idea of selling virtue is that different people have different definitions of what virtuous behavior is. So I thought, since we're not the first people to ever come up with this idea, I thought we might take a look at what the philosophers have spoken about and see if we can find a way to kind of bring these into the modern age. So for many centuries, there's been the idea of seven deadly sins, and opposing them are what are sometimes called the seven cardinal virtues. So I thought we'd do a show on each one of those. And to lead things off, what better top of the order batter than the one that's probably going to be the toughest sell in all of modern society, and that is the cardinal virtue of chastity, which is considered kind of an antidote to the cardinal sin of lust. There's an awful lot of lust out there in our culture today, isn't there?
Indeed, there is. Oh, we're going to talk about lust. Oh, honey, I do believe I just got the vapor. Let's talk about it.
Yeah, let's.
Only in 15 minutes? Okay.
Yeah, well, it's a start.
Right. Someone would be like, yeah, well, that should be normal for you guys. Let's talk about us. Let's do it anyway. What you got?
Well, I got this, basically. We'll start with the obvious one, which is kind of carnal lust. I think it's possible to lust about many other things, but let's just start off with the one that's pretty straightforward. Our society is sexualized in a way that it's never been before, at least not since the final days of the Romans anyway, that I'm aware of. And this sexualization of everything has consequences, and especially consequences against young people. When you're a teenager and you're entering adolescence, this is a very confusing time. You're never so insecure in your life. And with so many societal pressures basically pushing young people into sexual relationships much earlier than we ever did in my generation. I mean, obviously for us, you probably wouldn't expect to kiss a girl till you were well into your 30s. But it's a real problem. It's not a joke, is it?
Not at all. And indeed, Bill, this ain't some new stuff. Even when it came to them Roman heathens, man, they were new kids on the blocks as a civilization, as far as that goes. This goes way back, right? And you know, the thing about lust, Bill, it's tapped into our instinct, right? And basically, what is this lust? It's basically an unchecked symptom of our instinct to mate. Is really what it comes down to. It's not like attraction. It's not like sexual urges is a bad thing. It just has to be measured with the discipline of like things like empathy, things like loyalty, right? It's not a bad thing to be attracted to somebody. That's not the issue. And some people, they even that, you're not supposed to do that. Like when we get to talking about chastity and stuff like that. These aren't problems. But it's the problem of when you start entertaining these things and you get to rolling with these things, that's when the problems really start to come out.
There's an obsessive quality to lust, isn't there, that sets it apart from just desire?
Oh, definitely. Well, like I said, we it's a natural thing for us to be driven by the instinct to mate. Right. And the instinct to mate in itself can be corrupted. And there's lots of things that can stimulate these things. But the bottom line is and especially when we're talking about virtue and we're talking about how we're going to go about these things as society. Once again, Bill, and I hate to sound redundant when I say this, it's virtue according to what? Even with lust, some people will justify lust. As you know, some people say like, hey, actually you're kind of crossing the line as far as that goes. And whereas another person will just say, hey man, I'm just being true to myself and I'm just being true to my desires and to my instincts. Therefore, that person actually thinks that they're virtuous and they can actually control their lust with whatever arbitrary measure they think that they can.
Well, now we're really down to kind of the main vein here, because I had a very interesting conversation with a Catholic priest who I do occasionally as a guest show a guest spot on his radio show. Mm-hmm. And he pointed out something I think is really the essence of it. He basically said that the cardinal virtues exist to steer us away from the deadly sins, and that each one of the deadly sins essentially represents something in our body, something in our physical flesh that prevents us from reaching peak happiness, and that they're considered sins because no matter how satisfying they may all be in the short term, if they weren't each one of them satisfying, then we wouldn't be doing them. But the ancient idea is that all of these things are bad for us because they get in the way of us leading the kind of life that leads to overall just happiness. And people who are consumed by lust and people who are very, very sexualized at a very early age are not very happy people.
Sure. Now, if we're going to bring up a religious approach to this, and I guess that's, you know, kind of what this is based on when we're talking about these virtues,
sure,
talking about these sins. The problem is that there's a approach to this, or an elixir or remedy from a legalistic standpoint or a systematic standpoint, that you're going to understand this system, this curriculum of what these desires are, or these inclinations that as human beings that we have. And when a person tries to abide by these things, nobody can live up to this statute. Nobody can. How these things have to be dealt with is on a whole nother level. And I'm gonna wax biblical here. This is the reason why the Lord says, hey, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. None of this stuff that you're gonna do because you think that there's some sort of merit in it, or because there's some sort of sanction against it, or anything like that. All these things are a disingenuous approach. What, you're gonna act all good because you're afraid of the measure of the law? It's like, no, it's love that keeps you from doing these things. If you wanna do these, and it's not like that, like God is some megalomaniac that says, you have to love me, you have to worship me and all this. No, that's hardly what it is. What it is like, look, man, I'm the author of love. I'm the author of these moral laws that you're assuming to go by. You need to square them by me, because if you don't, and you try to do this according to what you think is right, you will hurt people. Your ideas of love, your ideas of loyalty, anything like that, you will assuredly hurt people. You need to square it by me. That way you actually know how to love each other correctly, and you will be able to discipline yourselves with things like concerning lust, you know, or things like chastity.
So what is it about, what is it do you think that God sees in monogamous relationships, marriage, commitment, all of that? If you're a young person today and you're saying, what's the big deal? So I have sex with a bunch of people. How's that hurting me? How would you answer that?
Well, the thing is, for the youth that are saying, what's the big deal? I'm having sex. I mean, well, they're canceling out their own argument, because it's like, okay, if you're saying, what's the big deal? Then why can't you wait? If it's no big deal, why are you in such a hurry to do it? Right. So now the thing is, where God is concerned, as far as marriage goes, like, look, man, I created sex. I ain't got no problem with it. I created, matter of fact, I created it to be darn good. I want you saying my name when you're doing it, okay? I want you calling my name out, right?
Wow.
So God is okay with it, you know. But in order for us to enjoy it without the baggage, you want to be able to relax when you have sex. It's supposed to be an enjoyable thing. How can you relax when you're worried about things like STD, when you're worried about hurting another person's feelings or anything like that, or things getting weird and all that sort of stuff? It's like, God, I didn't design sex for that. It's supposed to be very enjoyable between a man and woman. Now, when you step outside of that, that's when we get into talking about the other things like gluttony and greed. It's like, why are you having sex outside of this natural statute that I made? Now you're going to really cause some problems. You know, so, you know, it's once again, and what's the elixir for that? Love.
Well, chastity, yeah. Chastity in the particular case of lust, the corresponding opposite virtue would be chastity, which would be basically abstinence. It's basically, as you said, it's just patience, it's waiting. And for people who don't understand this dynamic, you really have to get into what the damage that lust does to people really amounts to in the practical world. You mentioned a couple of practical examples. Unwanted pregnancies is certainly one of them. Out of wedlock births and so on. The idea that the way things seem to happen is that a woman is responsible for raising children when there's no father. The father's not there because there was no commitment. And there was no commitment because there was no abstinence, and people basically submitted to lust. But I think it's much deeper and worse than that, especially for very young people who don't have their own sense of self-identity established yet. They have an extraordinarily intimate connection with somebody else. And if it's based essentially on lust and there's nothing underneath it, then they get to immediately experience this sense of betrayal, which comes from, last night we were sleeping on each other's shoulders and now you don't even recognize me in the hallway anymore.
Right.
How does that make me feel?
Right, right. And see, once again, that's where there's this covenant of marriage that came in. Right. It's like, look, you know, if you guys are going to commit to each other, then go ahead and commit to each other. This lust that you have, it has to be disciplined by a sense of, once again, loyalty, empathy. It's like, how could you do this? Would you want that done to you? Right. It's kind of like, you know, when people think that Jesus is being extreme when he says, like, hey, man, even if you lust after another woman, even in your heart, that's still adultery. Why is that? Well, because when you're with your significant other, when you're with your spouse, do you want your spouse thinking about somebody else? Do you want your spouse playing the highlight reel, you know, while you're on the job? You know what I'm saying? So it's like, you wouldn't want that person doing that to you. Why would you do it to another person? So Jesus is like saying, hey, don't be a hypocrite about your relationships. Do unto others as you would want them do unto you. You wouldn't want to be left strapped.
That's a great point. That do unto others point. That's really a great point. And this is the problem with virtue, isn't it? Is that virtue is a big, big, heavy rock. Your behavior is a gigantic boulder. And that's the biology that we're all born with. And virtue is basically telling you to roll that rock up the hill. Mm. And sin is telling you, nah, just roll with it. Sin rolls downhill. It's much easier to destroy something in it than it is to build something. It's easier to live with a backyard that's nothing but weeds than it is with a well-manicured yard. Virtue is pushing something uphill. And so the question becomes, if you're going to go to all this effort to live contrary to the desires of the flesh, then there's got to be some reason for it. There has to be something that comes out of it. And in the case of chastity and abstinence, I think the byproduct of that, and the reason that chastity is considered a virtue, is I think the byproduct is ultimately self-respect. I think that's what really comes down to.
Well, it is, but there's a thin line, I guess, between self-respect. Actually, I wouldn't call it a thin line, a self-respect and self-righteousness. Because you can have a person who will take chastity and take this very zealous approach to it and think that having no sex is the same thing as being pure. And I say assuredly, it has nothing to do with each other. The test of having no sex is not a test of purity, especially where God is concerned. It's like, look, I told you, it's not good for man and woman to be alone. I created you guys to have this as pleasurable to each other. The test of purity and the demonstration of purity is that can you stick to my ordinance of sex, be with each other, lust after each other. I want, it's like, look, man, when I brought Eve to Adam, brother, I brought her butt naked, right? And so Adam was like, hey, God, I'm digging this thing that you did. So it's very okay for Adam to be attracted. It's very okay for them to be attracted. And God wants us to keep that with each other.
Okay, so now you've gotten to the point. You've really gotten down to it. It's not the lust even so much that's the issue as it is the violation of the commitment, right? I mean, that lusting after your own partner is good and natural and all the rest of it. So let's take a slightly different definition of this before we wrap this up. One of the things that I think really offsets that term lust and what makes chastity or abstinence a virtue in itself is it's a form of mental discipline. It's a form of releasing something that you know isn't good for you. It's a way of climbing out of an addiction, basically. Lust has an obsessive quality to it. As I said before, it's different than desire or wanting something. When you say that somebody lusts after something, I'm always struck by the idea that there is nothing else in that person's life, that this is a absolute monomania. It is an obsession, and it is a fixation on something that you can't have. And most of what drives lust is the fact that you can't have it. One of the reasons that chastity is there is to protect us from the fact that the problem with lust is, most of the time, when you lust after someone or something, the second you get it, you don't want it anymore.
Well, that can be demonstrated with the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Adam and Eve were basically suckered into lusting after something that they thought they weren't supposed to have. And when they got it, they definitely didn't want it anymore, because it amounted to death, right? So they didn't want this thing anymore. But the other issue with lust, Bill, is the fulfillment. It's just like you're talking about. It's empty fulfillment. You can't be fulfilled by it. And I think a lot of people, you know, especially in a religious sense, when they think about lust, and they think about the connotations that go along with, like, sex, they'll even translate that into marriage. And they take things like, you know, God saying in these days, when it comes to the end, people will be eating and they'll be drinking, they'll be given over to marriage and stuff like that. And they take those things to mean sin, right? Well, it's not a sin to eat. It's not a sin to drink. It's not a sin to be married, because once again, people associate marriage with sex. And for some reason, that cancels out purity. It does not. The problem is people seeking fulfillment in it. If a person is seeking fulfillment in what they eat, that becomes an obsessive eating disorder. Drinking becomes drunkenness. Marriage, it becomes perversions of marriage. When people impose this sense of, I need you to complete me, and they're looking for another person to complete them, this is idolatry. And this is one of the reasons why our divorce rate is so high in America, and because marriage is taking on all sorts of different definitions, because people are trying to seek fulfillment in something that really isn't supposed to fulfill them.
So all of these virtues, when it's all said and done, what we find is they're various forms of discipline. They're mental discipline designed to keep us from overindulging in any of these areas that cause us harm. And that's why they're so damn difficult to deal with. Great talking with you, Zoe. We'll see you on the next episode when we talk about gluttony and temperance.
Ooh, fun. Thanks for having me, Bill.
My pleasure. Thanks again for the members at BillWhittle.com for making this show possible.